times. This has been the great test of all the great civilizations throughout history, is that when the time came, the average citizen said, I will sacrifice myself for the country.
And these kids didn't want to be there. You know, 17, 18, 19 years old, they wanted to be shooting 22s at rabbits, not M1s at other young men. They wanted to be throwing softballs, not hand grenades. But there was an evil force loose in the world, and it fell to them to have to deal with it, because when the challenge came that the society said to them, you got to go out there and fight, and they did.
30 seconds! God be with you!
Stand out of your weapons. Keep those actions clear. I'll see you on the beach.
Move your men off the beach! Down! Now!
Saving Private Ryan, a film by Steven Spielberg. Starring two-time Academy Award winner Tom Hanks as Captain John Miller.
Clear the shingle!
Is the story of heroism and sacrifice, set in France during the D-Day invasion of World War II, where eight soldiers risked their lives on a perilous mission to save one man.
Some private in the 101st lost three of his brothers, and he's got a ticket home.
I don't know anything about Ryan. I don't care. I'm gonna find him so he can go home. If that earns me the right to get back to my wife, well, then that's my mission.
This is what it comes down to. This is what our orders are. Go find this one guy so he can go home while the rest of us stay here and fight the war. It's an obtuse concept, but there's no arguing with it. They just have to get it done.
The principal mission was to rescue someone for a good reason. And that attracted me to the story. That moved me.
Ryan, anybody know Ryan? 101st Airborne, Ryan, you know a guy named Ryan? Private James Ryan from Iowa?
This ensemble cast includes Edward Burns, Tom Sizemore, Matt Damon, Giovanni Ribisi, Barry Pepper, Jeremy Davies, Adam Goldberg, and Vin Diesel.
You want to explain the math of this to me? I mean, where's the sense of risking the lives of the eight of us to save one guy?
20 degrees. Anybody want to answer that?
This is about that great cadre of citizen soldiers, the guys who just joined, who enlisted because it was the right thing to do, who really their only job is to win the war so everybody can go home.
There's not a reason why, there's but to do and die.
They're ordinary men in extraordinary circumstances, and they behave extraordinarily.
Go!
Nobody was prepared for how horrific it really was. And you really got a sense of what these guys had to go through.
These guys do just what they're not supposed to do, which is care about one another. It's one of the tragedies of war, you know, that you lose your friends.
Fucking get out!
Regardless of what the words on paper were, and regardless how we worked out the story, this was going to be some brand of current, definitive document about a day of decision unlike any other, certainly in the history of the world.
Destroy Hitler's empire. Smash it by air, break it wide open, then invade by sea. That was the directive.
D-Day was the pivot point of the 20th century. It was the day on which it was decided whether this world was going to be Nazi or was going to be democratic.
The night before D-Day probably was the most exciting night in our history. Those planes started to take off about 9 to 10 o'clock at night. They were coming over us at about 500 feet with their lights blinking. And then one of those planes was my brother, who was a young lieutenant in the 101st Airborne. And needless to say, I had a long prayer not only for him, but for the thousands of those guys who were within a half hour of being in combat.
I was getting scared. I was frightened to death. It was very quiet on the plane, and the first thing I pulled out was my rosary, and I kept saying these rosaries one right after another. And someone next to me asked if he could borrow my rosary. And I said, no, I'm busy using it. I prayed all the way across until we hit the coastline.
I used to tell people that one of the greatest lies on earth was when the jump master would say, are you ready? And everybody said, yes. If you don't know what fear is, you'll be introduced to it rather quickly as you go out the door.
What I was thinking on the way down, I can't remember thinking of anything other than just this terrible fear. I don't think I was ever more afraid of anything in my life than at that moment.
The sizes of the forces involved were gargantuan. This was the biggest amphibious operation in all human history. Guys were thinking that this is going to be pretty easy. Maybe the Air Force has killed all those Germans with the pre-bombardment. Actually, they hadn't hit anything.
Most of the young men that landed on Utah and Omaha Beach had never landed on a beach before. This was their first time they'd ever fought in a war.
When those ramps went down on those Higgins boats with that very first wave, and those Germans who had been waiting and had been watching and they were holding their fire, thousands and thousands of them, rifles, machine guns, mortars, big cannon. I swear to God, in some of those boats, everybody got killed before anybody got out. It was just a wall of steel that hit them.
First of all, it was chaos. That's the only word that you can use to describe what the hell was going on. Why are we doing this? I said to myself, why am I doing this? And dig a hole and try to get below the firing squad and all that. And closer you get to the ground, the longer you're going to live. That was my motto anyhow.
How afraid these young guys must have been. And they were so tired and soaking wet with all their wool and all their layers of clothing and all their gear and ammunition and weapons that when they stepped off of those boats and seeing all of their pals dying around them, they were so exhausted and seasick that all they could do was crawl up those beaches.
But they kept coming and working their way across that beach and getting up to that seawall. The tendency was overwhelming. Yet every instinct in them said, get down as low as you can and just stay there. This is an unhealthy place. And this was a battle from which there was no retreat. There wasn't any way to go back. So you either stayed there and got killed, or you did something about it. What happened was that over here a captain, over here a second lieutenant, down there a sergeant, who had men around him, he didn't even know their names. The confusion was so great. He said, screw this. I ain't gonna get killed here. I'm going up that bluff and I'm gonna take some Germans with me. Now who's coming with me?
They had to cross that expanse of open beach with that blistering gunfire from all directions and to wade through it, and some of them survive and go on and achieve the monumental moment that D-Day was. It was a watershed that will be focused on in history forever.
It's not hard to imagine, you know, what it must have looked like. What it must have felt like, however, is something that guys like myself will never know. Never, never in a million years.
I've kind of had an obsession with World War II. It originated with my father, who fought World War II in Burma and came back to tell all the stories to the family about what happened. He was in the Air Force, and he was the radio operator on board a B-25. I saw a lot of 16-millimeter movies that my dad took when he was over there in India. So I grew up with these shots of my dad cleaning his 50 caliber machine gun, pictures of him on a bicycle, everybody bicycled all through that region. And just stories about his buddies and all the great friends he made. I certainly think, you know, that my dad planted the seed in the sense that when he told war stories, you know, he wasn't trying to dissuade me from being interested in war. He didn't tell me horror stories about the war. He told me stories that made me want to know more about it.
He listened. And I think he absorbed it and sort of internalized it and put it into a system, because it comes out in the movies later about how he feels.
Television was right there in our world, and there were films like The Fighting Seabees and films like The Story of G.I. Joe and Back to Bataan and Sands of Iwo Jima. So between my father's stories and John Wayne's presence in these films, you know, as a youngster, I got the impression that, you know, war was something to be glorified, to be looked at with a kind of awe.
When he was a kid, he would take my movie camera and use it. He said, Dad, come on, let me take the pictures. You know, yours don't look so hot, you know. And we let him do it.
I was about 13, 14 years old, and I made a couple of war films. They were like little mini Hollywood films filled with glory and storming the outpost and taking the hill. And, you know, it was all that macho gung-ho stuff that World War II movies kind of delivered to us.
They'd take a bunch of kids and they'd dye shirts dark and light so they could be the Nazis and the Americans. And they played desert warfare out in the desert in Phoenix. First, he wanted to use real explosives, but I wouldn't go to the drugstore and buy gunpowder and make explosives. So we used this mud trick, and it worked pretty good. We'd take a stick and bury one end of the stick in the mud and pivot it on a stone. The kid that was acting as a soldier who was supposed to get blown up would run up to that thing, step on the other end of the stick, flip the mud in the air, which looked like an explosion, and fall on his face and contort and roll over and all kinds of stuff like that.
It was just making it up. We didn't have any special effects expertise. I didn't read any books. It was just, how do you make this come to life?
I'm in Escape to Nowhere, the guy driving the Jeep. Scrunched out so he looks real small.
Fighter Squadron was a movie I made around the same age I made Escape to Nowhere. It was in black and white. It was my first time I ever made a black and white movie, actually, and because I kind of had seen all the documentaries of World War II, and they were all in black and white in those days. And went out to the Sky Harbor Airport in Phoenix, and they had a whole bunch of old World War II airplanes and mothballs. You know, they had P-40s, they had Thunderbolts, they had F-6F Hellcats. They were all kind of lined up. My dad got permission to let us sit in the cockpit of a couple of these airplanes. My dad actually did all my costumes for me because I used the actual, you know, outfit that he brought back from Burma to make these movies with. So if I had 9 kids flying these airplanes, I actually only had 1 airplane. I only had 1 leather helmet with 1 set of goggles. They just kept trading them off. And in those days, when 8mm was all the rage, camera shops also sold documentaries from World War II. So I just intercut a 14-year-old kid in my dad's leather hat flying this airplane with actual gun camera footage from these documentaries you could buy at any camera store.
Steve would get up with a camera, and he'd have another kid in the cockpit. And when he wanted to show the plane banking, he would take the camera and just turn it like that, and then straighten it back up again. When you saw it on the screen, it looked like the plane went down like that, you know.
Sort of between reality and fantasy spliced this World War II Air Force story together. Clearly, half of my films take place in the 1930s and 40s. When you look at the Raiders films, when you look at Empire of the Sun, when you look at 1941, my comedy, even Schindler's List, which I don't consider a war film, I think the Holocaust sort of is in a category all its own. I've had windows into war in many films that I've directed, little pockets of sequences, a little bit like war, but I don't think I've ever done anything like this movie. I don't think I've ever done anything closely resembling the war that we've attempted to bring to life in Private Ryan.
I have never seen anything remotely close to this for realism, for exactly what the men that I have interviewed over the past 30 years on this battle have told me about what happened.
Want to see plenty of beef between men.
We were on the landing craft, and it was literally the moment when the ramps came down. And all I saw was the ramp go down and the first 3 or 4 rows of soldiers literally get blown to bits. I realized that we were making a very, very different sort of movie than had ever been made before in regards to this thing, just in the gritty reality of the detail.
Dog one exit, right here! Good business!
We all felt we were laboring not just to get it right, but we were also laboring in order to get it accurate, despite how gruesome and despite how painful.
Spielberg makes you look at the consequences of war. He makes you look at these young kids, the terror, the confusion, the chaos, the noise, the heartbreak of these young lives being stamped out.
I was looking for realism all the time.
They want us to take the children.
No, we can't take the kids.
No,
we can't
take the kids.
I didn't want to shoot the picture in a way that would seem like a Hollywood production coming to Omaha Beach and making a gung-ho extravaganza.
Hey, no!
America!
This is really trying to approximate the look and the smells of what battle and combat is really like.
Captain, the decent thing to do is to at least take you down the road to the next town.
We're not here to do the decent thing. We're here to follow orders.
Before they started filming, Dale Dye, our technical consultant, Captain Dye, took him through basic training in the field, and they were put through the grist mill.
Let's get those dog and easy people in there.
I believe that there is a certain heart and a certain spirit that's common throughout fighting men. And I think that actors who are like dry sponges until you pour on the water need to be immersed in the rigorous lifestyle, in the horrors that infantrymen and combat people all over the world face.
On paper, it sounds fantastic, but when you're out there, yeah, I found plenty of arguments against it.
The actual experience of it was, I think it's almost indescribable.
It was the worst experience of my life. I mean, it really was. It was physically exhausting and tough.
We hiked all over the place, and it was raining, and it was cold, and it was wet, and we slept on the ground, and we ate food that came out of cans, and were heated up over, you know, little tiny stoves. We had him constantly yelling at us because we were doing things wrong, and learned various combat techniques.
I immerse those actors in that lifestyle. I take them to the field, I make them eat rations, I shoot at them with blank ammunition, I beat them up, I beat on them, I make them crawl and sleep in the mud and the cold and the dirt. And when they come out the other end, if I've done my job successfully, they have at least an inkling of what it's like, the deprivations, the hardships that people sacrifice to serve their country in the military.
The only way to really, you know, get through it was to kind of shut down myself and become, you know, the soldiers.
It all sort of, after a while, became second nature. You know, you don't really have to think about it after a while.
It was something that I'd probably never do again, but something that I'll always be thankful that I completed.
It brought us closer together, so when we started shooting the movie, you know, we felt a bond, that we had gone through something very difficult together.
I just know that when the guys showed up on the set, they were born again hard. Those 5 days put them in a frame of mind where they understood that we weren't playing around, that we were making a serious picture about war.
We're handed a task here, in one way, in order to do it service, to do it right and do it entertainingly and do it effectively and all that. But we also want to make sure that we're accurately capturing, you know, the look behind the eyes of the guys we're portraying.
I told things to the guy in a foxhole that I never told to my confessor. I was closer with some of these guys than I was with my brother.
The relations between the men in a squad and how they come to love each other and how they develop something that goes beyond friendship, ready to die for each other. That's how close men in combat get. There's nothing to compare with in civilian life. That is caught just exactly right.
We'll take it! You fall back!
You'll be right behind us!
Soon as we're in business!
They know they should get out of there. Everything tells them they should run, but they don't. They stay. And other people see them stay and they come back to help them. They're the ones who win the wars.
You never knew if you were going to be around for the next morning or the next day. It's just 1 minute at a time. It was just overwhelming. So many people were being killed around us. We just hoped that we wouldn't be the one that would be left behind. It was frightening for a soldier that's 18 years old.
Each day I would check the list of dead coming into the cemeteries, particularly I was watching for my brother. Bob got to about 2 miles of our lines when he came to a river and he had a young corporal with him. Kid couldn't swim, and there was a German sentry up on a bridge, and Bob went up to get the sentry and was killed in a place near Würzburg. So we had our losses in the Harrison family. 1 out of 2.
Brothers like to serve together for obvious reasons. I know guys that had 1 or 2 brothers killed in Normandy. It happened. The most famously with the Sullivan brothers, 5 brothers, 1 ship. The ship went down, all 5 of them died. Policy then became in the Navy, brothers can't serve in the same ship. And in the Army, we keep them out of the same division and try to keep them out of the same battle. But of course, the Army's battles were so big, there were a lot of brothers serving who were always taking the risk of being killed in the same day, but not in the same battle.
My grandmother sent 4 sons to war.
In the articles, our scrapbook, it kind of says the Nylons are going to war. So-and-so enlisted when, and it was a very kind of a pride thing among the Nylons.
There were four Nylon boys. Edward was the oldest. He was 31. Preston was 29. Robert was 25. And Fritz was 24.
You have to understand, these were young, gorgeous men on their way to a beautiful life.
When they made the commitment to be soldiers, they were going to be the best damn soldiers there were.
Well, they wrote beautiful letters. They worshiped their mother. And they wrote in one of the letters, no one can say the four Nylon boys were draft dodgers.
Please, Mom, don't worry. Everything is going to turn out fine. Just watch and pray and hope. Don't worry, Mom, please, because all of your boys will come back home safely. This war will be over soon. Some night we will all be together again, and it will seem like everything was just a great big dream.
Uncle Bobby was killed D-Day, and Preston was killed D+1 day. My father, Fritz, was shot down behind enemy lines, and then May 20th, my Uncle Eddie was shot down in Burma and missing in action and presumed dead. So within this very tight time frame, my grandparents thought they had lost every son in the war. And when they realized Fritz was alive, they went looking for him to bring him back.
Fritz was then brought out and sent home because he was the only known survivor of the family.
It was 18 months before my Uncle Eddie escaped from a Japanese prison camp and they realized he was alive. There is a legacy of honor that goes with this family, and that's why we're very proud.
The sight of that Western Union kid riding that bicycle up to a house just struck terror into your heart. Now, imagine what it must have been like to get three telegrams in the course of the war. Imagine getting three in the same day. Freedom doesn't come for free. Those gold stars that would be in the windows meant that their boy wasn't going to come home. They put it in the window, and you knew then that at that house, the husband or the son had paid the last full measure of devotion. And they were never going to see him again. And that's why we're free, because he gave his life.
This movie is about the veterans. It's for the veterans of World War II. We talked about that often when we made the picture. We said this is for them.
I think it's important to keep telling the stories, understanding them, and understanding what the basis for this was. The more you talk about the horrors of a war, the more you are less likely to try to get involved in another one.
It's important that we remember the men of World War II because it's thanks to them that we live in this world of freedom today.
You know, they deserve applause. In all honesty, they deserve medals, and they deserve honors, and they deserve parades, but they also deserve our thanks for the sacrifices they made when they were very young men.
It's important to remember that there were people willing to die for the country. They're willing to give their lives.
We all owe a lot to people that are too easy to forget about because we're so busy trying to satisfy our own contemporary lives. If it weren't for those veterans, none of us would be having the lives we're having today.
Everybody who complains about going to work at 8 o'clock in the morning somewhere should come here and look down this stretch of beach and consider what was asked of that generation to do on June the 6th, 1944.
Someday we might look back on this and decide that Saving Private Ryan was the one decent thing we were able to pull out of this whole god-awful mess.